Now, how does this improve scope of transfer phenomena compared to the scope of thermodynamics? Okay. Now, as I told you, we predict the actual performance size of the equipment. What does it mean? Okay. Let us go back to our examples. In the earlier case, we predicted the power required for compression of the feed gas. It was a minimum value. If we predict based on process calculation course, it is less accurate. If you predict based on the thermodynamics course, it is still more accurate, but still it is a minimum value. You are not getting the actual value. But using a transfer phenomenon approach, you find out the actual value, which will be much more closer to reality. Okay. Now, similarly, the conversion of hydrogen in the reactor, we found out the maximum value either based on assumption that the gases behave ideally or they behave non-ideally, but still gives the maximum value only. But using a transfer phenomenon approach, you can find out the actual value of conversion based on the size of the reactor. And the composition of vapor leaving the condensate refrigerator, they were found out assuming phase equilibrium. Once again, of lower accuracy with process calculation knowledge, still more accuracy with using a thermodynamics knowledge, but still they are equilibrium values. Suppose you want to find out the actual value, which is related to the size of the equipment, size of the heat exchanger, then you need to use a transfer phenomenon approach. So, we have said that the size of the equipments is not under the purview of thermodynamics. Moment we use a transfer phenomenon approach, we can determine the size of the reactor, meaning the mass of catalyst, length of tubes, number of tubes. We can find out the size of the condenser refrigerator, which is heat exchanger, find out the area of heat exchanger, the length of tubes, number of tubes, and of course, size of the liquid vapor separator, namely height and diameter. So, to find out the size of these equipments, we need transfer phenomenon approach, and to consider the include the size of these equipments on the performance, we require a transfer phenomenon approach. So, what we will do is take several examples, not necessarily connected to this flow sheet. Take several examples from fluid mechanics, heat transfer and mass transfer, and then compare the scope of thermodynamics and scope of transfer phenomena approach. That will also give you what are the scope of transfer phenomena and how does it compare with the thermodynamic approach. Okay. Okay. So, first example which you are going to consider is power required for pumping. Okay. Suppose if we have water to be pumped from one level to another, and then you are using a pump, let us say household example of pumping water from a sump to overhead tank. Okay. And if you use a thermodynamic approach, that will give you the minimum power required to pump water from one level to another level. Okay. Which, because it neglects frictional losses, it gives you only the minimum pumping power required. Okay. But if you use a transfer phenomena approach, you can calculate the actual power required. Why is it possible? Because we include frictional losses, the liquid flows through the pipe, losses due to friction happen because of the contact to the wall, we include that. So, you can calculate what is the actual work required or power required to pump water from one level to the other. And so, more, of course, we know more work has to be supplied compared to the idle work that is predicted from thermodynamics. So, thermodynamic approach gives the minimum work required, transfer phenomena approach gives us the actual work required including the frictional losses. Okay. An analogous example is flow through a pipe. Suppose if you have a flow of let us say a liquid flowing through a horizontal pipe, no change in cross section, thermodynamic approach will not give us any pressure drop at all. Okay. But if you consider a transfer phenomena approach, you include the frictional losses and you can find out the pressure drop due to flow through this pipe because of friction of the wall. Also, you can calculate what is the velocity profile across the cross section of the pipe. The velocity is 0 at this position which is in contact with the wall, and it is maximum at this position. So, velocity varies across this cross section. So, transfer phenomena approach will also help us to find out what is the velocity profile across this pipe. So, one is transfer phenomena approach gives the max, the actual work required, and also includes friction and gives the velocity profile as well. Next example is from heat transfer. Consider two examples here. The first example is heat transfer in a furnace wall. Let us say I have a furnace and this is a furnace wall, and let us say you have a high temperature here and a low temperature here. Okay. So, what is the scope of thermodynamics? Thermodynamics will tell you what is the direction of heat transfer, tell you the direction of heat transfer, and then which is the direction of temperature decrease, but does not consider the rate of heat transfer. But if you use a transfer phenomena approach, it considers the rate of heat transfer by conduction, which is due to temperature gradient, okay. And you can calculate what is the rate of heat transfer taking place through this furnace wall, and also calculate what is the temperature profile across the width of this furnace wall. Okay. So, while thermodynamics tells you the direction of heat transfer, transfer phenomena tells you what is the rate of heat transfer, how fast it takes place, also tells you the temperature profile, how temperature varies along the thickness of the furnace wall. Okay. Now, another example, a simple example would be, suppose if you take little warm water and then place it in a ambient temperature and allow it to cool, what does thermodynamics tells you? It tells you the final equilibrium temperature, which is the same as ambient temperature, but thermodynamics does not tell you how fast the equilibrium will be reached, does not tell you how the temperature varies as a function of time, how long it takes to reach equilibrium. Okay. Now, or how the temperature reaches the equilibrium value, either linearly, exponentially, does not come out from a thermodynamic analysis. Okay. If you use a transfer phenomena approach, you can find out how the temperature cools down, how the temperature cools down from the high temperature to the ambient temperature, and also find out how long it takes to reach the equilibrium value. Okay. So, as we have discussed earlier, all the time factor, length factor, area factor are all considered in the transfer phenomena approach. Okay. Okay. Now, another example from heat transfer with respect to heat exchanger. Let us say I have a heat exchanger, and then you are given two inlet temperatures, and then you are given one outlet temperature. And let us say inlet temperature is the hot and cold fluid, and you are given the outlet temperature of the hot fluid also. Now, using a simple energy balance, which is based on thermodynamics, you can find out what is the outlet temperature of the fluid, okay, and outlet temperature of the cold fluid. Now, rate of heat transfer is not considered. So, the area of the heat exchanger, which we said is equivalent to size, length, etcetera, of the heat exchanger is not considered. We also do not consider and take into account the direction of the flow, whether they flow counter current to each other or co-current to each other. Okay. So, thermodynamics will tell you what is the outlet temperature of cold fluid, no doubt about it, but does not consider the rate of heat transfer. Hence, the size of the heat exchanger is not considered, and does not consider and take into account what is the influence of the direction of relative direction of motion between the two streams, whether co-current or counter-current. Okay. But if you use a transfer phenomena approach, let us take the same case, you are given two inlet temperatures and one outlet temperature. Transfer phenomena approach considers the rate of heat transfer, and that rate of heat transfer is proportional to the temperature difference between these two fluid streams, the hot and cold fluid streams, and hence you can determine the area and length of heat exchanger, what is the temperature profile along the length of heat exchanger. You can also answer the question whether a countercurrent mode or a co-current mode is better for contact. Okay. So, just because it takes into account the rate of heat transfer, you can, your scope of analysis, scope of prediction widens a lot. As we have seen here, the length of heat exchanger, the temperature profile along the length, and also the influence of relative contacting direction was also taken into account. Now, few examples from mass transfer. The first example is the vaporization of a solvent. Let us say we have a very volatile solvent and we like to predict the rate of vaporization of the solvent. Okay. So, if you use a thermodynamic approach, use the Raoult's law. What can Raoult's law give us? Raoult's law can give us what is the concentration of this volatile solvent in the gas which is in just contact with the liquid phase. Okay. So, that gives a saturation value, and that is all, that is the scope of thermodynamics. Okay. It does not consider the rate of mass transfer, it does not give the rate of mass loss of solvent. Okay. But if you use the transfer phenomena approach, okay, we consider the rate of mass transfer, which is your diffusion, which is depends on the concentration gradient between, let us say, the surface of the liquid and the top of the tube. Because of this, we can determine the rate of loss of solvent and the concentration profile along the length of the tube as well. Okay. So, transfer phenomena approach considers the rate of mass transfer. In this case, is because of diffusion. Diffusion is because of concentration gradient. Because of that, we can find out or predict what is the rate of loss of solvent. What does it mean? Suppose if you leave this tube for, let us say, a day or two, how much would the solvent would have been evaporated. Okay. And of course, it is going to be very, very less quantity, but still you can find out what is the rate of loss of solvent. And of course, you can find out what is the concentration profile of solvent vapor along the length of the tube. Okay. Another household and then mouth watering example would be, let us say you have raw gulab jamun and then putting in sugar syrup, equilibrium sugar concentration can be predicted from thermodynamics. But if you are very eager to take the gulab jamun, the transfer phenomena will tell you how long you have to wait, and if you are still more interested, you can predict the concentration profile of sugar inside the gulab jamun. Okay. So, that is the scope of transfer phenomena in terms of rate and then the concentration profile. Okay. Okay. Another example from mass transfer, more to do with chemical engineering, application of absorption. Suppose if you have a stream of air and ammonia and you want to absorb ammonia using water, if it is a thermodynamic approach, we use Henry's law, and then based on that you will find out what is the equilibrium concentration of the gas and liquid phases. You are given the, let us say, the inlet concentration of liquid, you are given the inlet concentration of gas, and you can, based on Henry's law, based on mass balance, you can find out what is the equilibrium concentration of the streams leaving. That is the concentration which they were given infinite time and they would attain. Okay. So, rate of mass transfer is not considered, that does not consider the height of the column, the direction of flow, something similar to heat exchanger. Now, if you use the transfer phenomena approach, you consider the rate of mass transfer. That rate of mass transfer depends on the difference between the actual concentration and the equilibrium concentration. That determines the rate of mass transfer between the two phases. Okay. Moment you take this rate into account, you can find out what is the height of column required to achieve a desired percentage removal. Okay. Let us say you want to remove 90% of removal, then what is the height of column, packed column required? And you can also find out the axial concentration of ammonia and the gas and liquid phase. Just like heat exchanger, we can find out is a coke current mode or counter current mode better. Okay. So, something analogous to our heat exchanger, there we had area, length of pipe, here we have height of column, there we have axial temperature profile, where we have concentration profile. Once again, there again we can analyze the relative direction of motion of fluids, here again we can do that. Okay. Okay, another example, very practical example related to wastewater treatment. Suppose if you have a colored water and then I want to remove color from it, use a adsorbent like activated carbon. Okay. So, what can thermodynamics tell us? Thermodynamics can tell us what is the maximum concentration in the solid phase if you allow it to equilibrium, which means a very, very long time the solid phase and the liquid phase reaches equilibrium, can find out what is the maximum concentration in the solid phase. Once again, does not consider rate of mass transfer. how long it takes to reach equilibrium is not in the scope of thermodynamics. Okay. Comes to a transfer phenomena approach, you consider the rate of mass transfer. Now, mass transfer takes place from the bulk liquid, it has to reach the solid surface, and then from the surface to the interior of solids. These rate of mass transfer of these two steps are considered, and you can find out what is the time required to reach equilibrium. Okay. So, rate of mass transfer helps us to find out what is the time required to reach equilibrium. Okay. Just one example from the reactor. Suppose we carry out a reaction in a reactor at a given temperature and pressure. What is shown is an example of a reactor where you have inflow and then outflow. And let us say I carry out a reaction in this and analyze this thermodynamically, and I can find out the maximum possible conversion as we have seen earlier. If it is an irreversible reaction, it tells it is 100%, okay. And if it is reversible, some limited conversion possible. Okay. Thermodynamics does not consider the kinetics of the reaction, it also does not consider the time of contact between the reactants, what is the time available for the reaction in the reactor, how long they spend, time spent by the reactants in the reactor. All these are not considered in arriving at the conversion. Okay. In fact, for thermodynamics, there is no size at all. I cannot draw even equipment based on thermodynamics. It is just a representation by a box. Okay. There is no size attached to our equipment. Okay. Come to the transfer phenomena approach. You calculate the actual conversion. How do you calculate the actual conversion? First, you take the kinetics of the reaction, include the rate constant, etcetera. Also, consider the volumetric flow rate of the reactants, consider the volume of vessel or weight of a catalyst, and also the what is the fluid flow pattern inside the reactors also considered in arriving at the conversion. Okay. So, transfer phenomena approach arrives at the actual conversion compared to the maximum value predicted from a thermodynamic approach. It considers the kinetics, the flow rates, the volume and the contacting pattern. Okay. Okay, so, that brings us to the summary of the first part of introduction. We started with experiments on theory, okay. Looked at measurements which we would like to predict using a model which we call as simulation, and prediction of process variables either based on thermodynamic approach or a transfer phenomena approach. Process calculation course just a subset of thermodynamic approach. Okay. The thermodynamic approach tells us the limits of performance, okay. Gives us minimum work required, equilibrium composition, maximum conversion. Okay. Does not consider rate of transfer, be it heat transfer, mass transfer, momentum transfer, and length, area, volume, time are all not in the scope of thermodynamics. Okay. All those are not considered. We saw transfer phenomena deals with flow of fluids, which is discussed under momentum transfer. Flow of energy or heat, which is discussed under heat transfer, and flow of species discussed under mass transfer. Okay. What is the scope of transfer phenomena approach? Considers the rate of momentum, heat, mass transfer. Because of that, we can calculate the dimensions, namely length, area, volume. Time is also brought into picture.